Thank God I'ma shoot high rats in the ass. And I'ma shoot a couple holes right in the bottom of their body. When I came to Chinatown in 1983, I was so wrapped up, I was in motion. Doing it well in the past, I came up in the welfare and under my thumb. Kicking me in the ass, it was powerful under my feet. Getting it down to a T, it was on the right track. Doing it well on the side of the ring, doing it well on the side of the ring, doing it well on the side of the ring, doing it well on the side of the ring. I kicked it well in the mold. I kicked it well in the hole. It was the best above the rest. I told you I thought about it twice. It was so right. I sworn it was on the right track. Doing it well on the side of the ring. Doing it well on the side of the ring. Doing it well on the side of the ring. Doing it well on the side of the ring. It was.
Who's the man? The answer is Wesley Willis. A 31-year-old artist, musician, with no formal art training, who suffers from, among other things, chronic schizophrenia.
You're damn right.
The main purpose of this video is to document how a pure artistic vision prevails. Even through the adversity of mental illness, poverty, and abuses of all types, he has succeeded and endured. Within the last couple of years, Wesley Willis has acquired a bit of notoriety through the sale of his drawings, appearances on ABC News, art shows, and numerous rock concerts.
250 times of doing this and it's still the same.
Downtown at the Merchandise Mart, a few different places, they'll feature him with other folk art exhibits. They'll have him like drawing live, you know?
Oh, really?
Different people call him up and he'll go down and do that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Does he get paid for that?
Yeah, I think, last time he went, I think he got $100 or something. And he sold drawings and fed him and treated him. Yeah. He's like the star.
He stood at street corners, in subways, all in order to sell his drawings and to survive. He doesn't just live to draw, he draws to live. His specialty is perspective drawings. They are all drawn directly from memory of an actual place. His canvas is a piece of board. His paintbrush is a Bic pen.
What was the most you ever seen him draw?
I'd say he was capable of probably knocking out, finishing two a day. Two good ones a day. Definitely at least one a day. And that's with all the interruptions and the schmoozing that would go on by him. Yeah. The customer, yeah. Or his battles with voices, right? The license plates and truck numbers, he puts in a lot of his drawings are real numbers. He doesn't make them up.
Oh, really?
Those are real numbers, like the car numbers on tractor trailers, on his trains going by. Those are real numbers that exist. Mm-hmm. Or you'll notice his bus ads on his bus drawings. They're exactly what was on the bus, you know?
His favorite subjects include the buildings of downtown, 35th and Dan Ryan, where he grew up, and his favorite are CTA buses. As of 1991, Wesley Willis has branched out into the recording of his own music to CD.
Who killed Officer Perkins? Who killed Officer Perkins? Who killed Officer Perkins? Stanley Davis shot Robert Perkins because he carried a gun. That was...
It's very ambitious recording schedule. Yeah, yeah. You know, considering most people are lucky to record 13 or even write 13 songs in a year,
yeah, yeah.
And actually record it. Wesley's brought in something like 120 songs this year.
What's there?
I think it's just a matter of how many tracks he can put down.
Yeah, total dedication, man. Yeah. It's just like...
totally wants to do what he does.
If all the musicians that came in here had as much dedication as he did, then a lot of good music would probably be getting pumped out.
Wesley Willis also fronts his own rock and roll band, the Wesley Willis Fiasco, on Spiral Records.
Walk with me and find out.
Well, we've got four bands that are officially, I guess, on the Spiral label, and we've got a couple under development deals. It's a growing thing. My safe is starting to back up with material, starting to get up to some frequency. But, it's a real organic thing. I basically am always open to new musical things going on. Wesley right now is real organic. I'm very anxious to start releasing full Wesley pieces. We want to do a full-length LP with the Fiasco, maybe throw a couple of solo songs on there. We're going to have to start recording that soon.
But to fully appreciate the man and where he's at now, it is necessary to understand where he came from.
You grew with those eyes.
Wesley Willis was born May 31st, 1963, to Annie and Walter Willis at Michael Reese Hospital on Chicago's South Side. He lived at 3746 South Lake Park, along with six brothers and three sisters, until the age of six.
Some of them are school teachers, some work in cafeterias, one's in the Army. Yeah, like a career Army, one of the sisters, from what he says. And he's always consistent telling me about this. So.
Did they ever write him?
As far as I know, there's no contact.
When, because of numerous complaints from others who told of the extreme abuse which was occurring at the Willis household, the family was split up. Some went to foster homes, others, such as Wesley, were sent to live with family. So, in 1968, Wesley was sent to live with his uncle in Phoenix, Illinois. He lived here for 10 years until his uncle was charged and arrested for the sexual abuse of a child. In 1978, at the age of 15, Wesley was sent back to Chicago. He lived in the foster home of Miss Rosella Howard. During this time, he attended Harper High School. Wesley lived here for 2 years until 1980. In 1980, at the age of 18, and having nowhere to go, he decided to move back home with his mother. His father, the one who perpetrated the majority of the domestic violence, had since moved out a few years back. His new home was the projects at 3739 South Federal. This is where someone even more dangerous than Wesley's father would enter his life. His name was Roger Lee Carpenter, Annie Willis's boyfriend. And he had a sadistic side which ran deep in his hatred for Annie's kids even deeper.
With his dad, and by that time his mom was with the boyfriend, who was another abusive pastor, the worst.
Wesley was the youngest. So by now, all the other siblings had moved out except Wesley's older brother, Ricky. Roger Lee Carpenter, through force, beatings, intimidation, and fear, would make Wesley watch as he beat Wesley's mother to a pulp. Roger Lee's favorite hobby was to make Wesley and Ricky watch as he received head from Annie Willis. Wesley's only escape was his art. In 1986, Roger moved everyone to 5152 Bishop. The beatings weren't as frequent now, but they still happened. Wesley knew he had to get out soon, but he felt a responsibility for his mother and decided it best to stay. In 1988, at the age of 25, the family was evicted and moved to 4601 South Indiana. By now, Wesley had been drawing seriously for 10 years and had gotten good enough to sell some. By 1989, Wesley had saved $600 to move out. Roger Lee Carpenter found out about the money. And at night, while Wesley was asleep, with a gun in his hand, he forcibly took the money from Wesley. This night, October 15th, 1989, is when Wesley started hearing the voices.
He's got it right down to the day, the event that like triggered him.
Oh, really?
He just freaked. I mean, it's real. He's real proud of the money he makes, and he had saved, you know, this amount, and this guy like was going to kill him for it, and it just.
Wesley was showing symptoms of severe schizophrenia at this time. Roger Lee Carpenter forced Wesley to move out. Having nowhere to go, at 27, Wesley moved back with his father at 740 East 43rd Street. Wesley was selling his drawings now as only means of support. He was now spending his days on the buses, downtown, and only returning to sleep. Around this time, Wesley would go to Genesis repeatedly to buy art supplies. During his many trips, he often ran into Dale Miners, an artist, musician himself. The two would become good friends and would later go on to form the Wesley Willis Fiasco.
Then it started like, I'm thinking to myself, wait a minute, this guy's always got a lot of money, and he doesn't have a job. I'm like, that's cool. And I'm like, this guy's got like, everybody knows who he is,
yeah.
You know? And like, everything about him is like so badass. And his art, like, I knew him for so long before I ever watched him draw, and he's badass, man. Like, he'll be talking to you, and I'm like, draw the book.
Wesley was also good friends with employees at Genesis, including Carla Winterbottom, Eric DeBatt, Bob Fredericks, Dave Kaplan, and Jim Sims.
He was there every day.
Yeah.
I mean, like, we hung out with him every day for like two years. Like every day, five times a week.
Is somebody waiting in line at a register at Genesis? Mm-hmm. Or somebody on the street or in a subway tunnel? I mean, Wesley just sucks him right into his space cage.
Dale helped find Wesley an apartment at 1435 Rockwell.
Bulletproof glass and like a police officer back there, you know? And we're like skinny white guys, hi, you know? It's so funny. We're like, we're here to see Wesley Willis, you know? So we kind of like moved him out. He had like a bag, you know, full of clothes kind of. And what else did he have? Oh, he had boxes and boxes of CDs. He had like this by just.
Finally, at age 27, Wesley was free.
I'm just crazy. I'm just having fun. My God.
You love that, huh?
Wesley got lonely, though, and would spend more time at Dale's loft at 1509 Milwaukee. But something tragic would happen to Wesley in 1991. Riding home on a bus on the south side, a man attacked Wesley with a box cutter and severely injured him. The man was arrested and charged. Wesley's first song would be about this incident.
Once upon a time, on the Ford Fiasco bus, I felt like I was on the floor. I was touched to myself. Suddenly, man, it was strange, but I was talking to him. Suddenly, he started yelling at me, fucking vulgar.
Then Dale moved Wesley into an apartment on 1930 North Drake with an old college friend, Phil Pennington.
About a year and a half ago, they lived together, and Wesley paid all the rent. The guy had two jobs, didn't pay any rent, saved up, bought a truck, basically used Wes and kind of, you know, Wes was just kind of emotionally a wreck at that time, you know, really upset about it. Didn't know whether Phil was a friend or a jerk, because Phil would really screw his head up. Like, I love you, Wesley, but then fuck him around royally, you know?
He was cool, and he and I were tight, but he kept, like, falling off more and more and more, and I haven't seen him in a while, but
Phil also liked to take Wesley to X-rated movies and adult bookstores. Wesley did not like either of these and decided it was time to move out once again.
So, I guess I just didn't understand that life that he was leading, you know? Like, when I went to pick up Wesley, man, we just, like, didn't understand, you know? It was just crazy.
And it was really hard. I mean, no one wanted him. You know, even the places that take people on SSI, he was either, like, too independent or not dependent enough for this or that. There was all...
In May 1993, Wesley Willis moved in with the manager of Genesis Artist Warehouse, Carla Winterbottom.
Every day, when I finally said, okay, move in here, month to month until you find somewhere, it's supposed to be temporary, but he, every day he'd be like, oh, it's so nice living here, you treat me so much better. And, you know, I think it was like the first stable, quiet environment he had in a while.
You
like that cereal, huh?
Yeah.
I'm gonna
get one ball. Hey, Carlo. I like you.
Sometimes he goes to Genesis Art Store to finish a drawing or sell one. It is just one of the many places Wesley goes to sell his art.
I just draw buildings because that keeps me going places and meeting people.
Really?
I'm a busy man. I'm an artist and a rock musician.
Besides selling drawings, Wesley also spends his day visiting friends.
Is it thick?
It's the one you had yesterday. You said you liked it.
Right? Yeah.
I asked you if you liked the new one.
I want a thin crust.
It's very light and crispy.
Light and crispy? Crispy like a hispy?
I was impressed.
By what?
By the fact that he is so sweet. He's got such a good heart. And that he's very talented.
Yeah, yeah.
And that he makes his own way in the world. And yeah. I'm impressed by anybody that is self-sufficient.
Waffles, will waffles make you fat?
Waffles will make you fat, Wes.
They will?
Yes, they will. Well, you have some fruit with your cereal.
I want to see, I'm going to see what I can do.
Well, I'm glad I finally got to meet you.
I know you did get to meet me because I'm just doing well. Got me on a nice big shirt. I took my medicine this morning.
Good for you.
Just to stop these mean voices from talking to me.
Right.
They've been talking to me with filthy vulgar language. And still, they do cuss me out.
But you ignore them.
Sometimes I ignore them, sometimes I yell at them.
Yeah, on the bus.
One time I was yelling at the Vincent Street bus, four police officers came and got me off. They told me to, control myself.
He went out to San Diego to play with the Digits.
Yeah.
And I was working with Carla, his roommate, on the travel situation. And I was worried because I know that people like Lucille Ball and just people who are some boisterous celebrities have been blacklisted from a lot of major airlines. And Wes has had trouble on the bus before. And so I was, you know, I was just concerned that perhaps you know, if he had any problems, he was flying on someone else's frequent flyer miles, and that he would get stranded in San Diego somehow. But when I was most worried about him, apparently everyone on the plane loved him so much. The pilot loved him, and he spent half the ride in the cockpit hanging out with pilots, and you know, just he's a star.
On occasion, Wesley must also show up for band rehearsals for any upcoming concerts which feature the Fiasco.
I said, Boston Chicken is the freshest thing going.
The verse parts, you're singing them way fast and you're slowing down. Remember,
yeah.
Spread them out like you did on the tape.
Yeah, I did good.
Except you were too fast.
Yeah, Boston Chicken is the freshest thing going.
But things are not always easy for Wesley. The voices are sometimes chronic and come in an endless assault. The medication only helps some of the time. His drawing and music are just as much of the therapy as the medication.
Heaven or hell, heaven or hell.
Besides drawing and making rock and roll music, Wesley loves to talk on the phone.
Hey, Keith, it's Wesley Willis. I'm going, okay, you big water tower head.
I would say they average out to $70 or $80 just in long distance. And it's like just state to state, so they're like $1, $2 calls. So, you know, he makes like there's at least 50 long distance calls in a month.
Wow.
And millions of local.
Well,
and he pays his bill. I mean, he just, you know, we mark off what part of the phone bill is whose, and he pays.
A bunch of brain rattle.
He also loves to give an affectionate bump on the head instead of a handshake.
I just like bumping heads because I'm a rock star.
He grew up in a housing project, you know, so some things that we take for granted,
yeah,
like he never did, you know, like I took him to Christmas at my sister's house like 3 years ago. He had like never opened a present before. You know, and it's like, so he opened one, he freaked. You know, like my sister's like, look under the tree, Wesley, there might be a present for you. And he found it, freaked, you know. So
the bad, but I'm this great dude, I just rock. I look with those big eyes. Open those eyes, look at me. Look at you, look at those eyes.
So how do you compose the songs for your for the words, Wes?
For the words?
Yeah, like how do you figure out how to make a song out of it?
Out of it?
Yeah.
Like this. Like this. Like this. Yeah. Like this. Yeah.
Yeah, the rhythm?
Yeah, I did.
On January 15, 1994, fans and friends were gathered at Sweet Alice's for a sold-out, standing-room-only concert featuring the Wesley Willis Fiasco.
I got to roll your mind to the soul. Are we ready to rock? Let's do it! Let's tear the motherfucking place up! Are you done cranking your guitar up?
Yeah.
Are you through cranking your guitar up?
Fucking ain't right, was it? I'm done cranking my guitar up, god damn it.
Yeah. I'm ready to make the fucking announcements right now. I'm gonna do it again. This is a hot ass rock and roll heavy metal song. I'm gonna do it again and I'm gonna do it right now, you motherfucker. Jesus is the answer. This is a hot ass song I'm gonna rip out. I'm gonna rub out this right now, and Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the answer. I know you're a fucking man when Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. I'm gonna very grateful to hear about that stuff. Take it to me. For me. Make it swear.
getting around.
I sung his song, Jesus the Answer, and I'm sorry that I got fat. That was the first two songs that I wrote. Mm-hmm. That was on a piece of plain paper, but it wasn't in a notebook. Yeah. Well, I went to Phil's house and got my songs. So I wrote them on my notebook.
How many notebooks full of songs do you have
left? At least 7.
How many keys on the keyboard?
61.
How many do you use?
14.
Why do you use only 14?
Because that's my way to sing a song. That's my way to sing that rock and roll and get crazy. And when I rock it like an apple. I'm just crazy, that's why them eyes are looking at me. Then you hit the line.
On Saturday night.
Saturday night?
Yeah. Did you play a concert?
Yeah.
What happened?
Everybody liked me.
Yeah?
I got up there and whipped ass. I was firewalling and throttled. And I'm going to firewall it some more. And thank God when I work hard, I'm just going to keep down like this.
What was it like living over on Federal?
Federal?
Yeah.
Or war zone.
Right.
You come home late at night, somebody is wanting to kill you. That's why I stay with him, Federal.
You saw it today, huh?
Yeah.
Drove past?
Yeah.
How'd you feel looking at that place again?
It was something else.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Did it bring back memories?
Yeah.
Do you miss it at all?
Hell no. I don't want to see that place no more. Yeah.
How many days have you been alive?
Years.
How many days?
Days? 10,956 days.
10,956.
Yeah.
Okay.
I've been alive 10,956 days.
How many of those are good days?
Well, 1,095.
That's it?
Yeah. The KM-1000?
Yeah.
The KM-1000?
Yeah.
It got stolen by Phil's friend.
Oh, how'd it get stolen?
Phil let his friend sleep over.
He took it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got so mad I wanted to kick his ass.
Did he say he was sorry?
He told me he was sorry, but I ain't believe that story. I told him I was gonna kick his ass. I told Phil I was gonna kick his ass. I told Phil Pennington that I was gonna kick his ass.
What?
I did a song about the evil mothers. I'm gonna write a song about Godzilla. I'm gonna write a song about Rodan. I'm so glad I got this keyboard so I can rock out and sing my black ass off.
Chicago, KFC, we do chicken right.
Hey, man.